Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Jaya Dvaita Gadadhara Shivasadi.
The following is a lecture given by His Holiness Jayapataka Swami on June 5, 1984 in New Vrindavan, West Virginia. The class begins with a reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam, 3rd Canto, Chapter 5, Verse 40.
Dhatar Yat Asmin Bhava Isa Jivas Tapa Traina Abhihata Na Sarma Atman Labhante Bhagavan Tava Angri Chayam Savidhyam Atha Asrayema Dhatar Yadasmin Bhava Isa Jivas Tapatraena Bihita Nasarma Atma Lavante Bhagavangstavangri Chayang Savidhyam Mata Asrayema Dhata Yadasmin Bhava Isa Jivas Tapa Traina Bihata Nasarma Atma Labhante Bhagavangstavangri Chayam Savidhyamata Asrayema O Father, yet, because, asmin, in this, Bhave, material world. Isa, O Lord. Jivaha, the living entities. Tapa, miseries. Traina, by the three. Abhihata, always embarrassed. Na, never. Sarma, in happiness. Atman, self, labhante, do gain, Bhagavan, personality of Godhead, tava, your, angri chayam, shade of your feet, savidyam, full of knowledge, ata, obtain, asrayema, shelter. Translation by His Divine Grace, Srila Avoychan Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. O Father, O Lord, O Personality of Godhead, the living entities in the material world can never have any happiness because they are overwhelmed by the three kinds of miseries. Therefore, they take shelter of the shade of your lotus feet, which are full of knowledge. And we also thus take shelter of them. Translation. O Father, O Lord, O Personality of Godhead, the living entities in the material world can never have any happiness because they are overwhelmed by the three kinds of miseries. Therefore, they take shelter of the shade of your lotus feet, which are full of knowledge. And we also thus take shelter of them. Purport. The way of devotional service is neither sentimental nor mundane. It is the path of reality by which a living entity can attain the transcendental happiness of being freed from the three kinds of material miseries. Miseries arising from the body and mind, from other living entities, and from natural disturbances. Everyone who is conditioned by material existence, whether he be a man or beast or demigod or bird, must suffer from adhyatmika, bodily or mental pains, adibhotic pains, those offered by living creatures, and adidaivik pains, those due to supernatural disturbances. His happiness is nothing but a hard struggle to get free from the miseries of conditioned life, of conditional life. But there is only one way he can be rescued, and that is by accepting the shelter of the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The argument that unless one has proper knowledge, one cannot be freed from material miseries is undoubtedly true. But because the lotus feet of the Lord are full of transcendental knowledge, acceptance of his lotus feet completes that necessity. We have already discussed this point in the first canto, 127. Vasudeve bhagavati bhakti yoga prayojita janayatyasu vairagyam gyanam cha yat ahaitukam. There is no want of knowledge in the devotional service of Vasudeva, the Personality of Godhead. He, the Lord, personally takes charge of dissipating the darkness of ignorance from the heart of a devotee. He confirms this in Bhagavad Gita 10:10. Teshang satada yuktanam bhajatang priti purvakam dadami buddhi jogang tang yena mamupayantite. Empiric philosophical speculation cannot give one relief from the threefold miseries of material existence simply to endeavor for knowledge without devoting oneself to the Lord is a waste of valuable time. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports, the Srimad and translation to the Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 3, Chapter 5, Text 40, in the matter of Vidura's talks with Maitreya. Here the demigods, they are engaging in praying to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, to the Personality of Godhead, Vishnu, because without the benediction of Vishnu, they are not able to proceed or to free themselves from the undesirable situations of material life. Actually, the demigods, they're all devotees of the Personality of Godhead. In the Vedas, the definition of Deva is Vishnu Bhakta, or a devotee of Vishnu. And the definition of Asura is a non-devotee, or someone who is a Vishnu Bidveshi, someone who is against Vishnu or Krishna. So when Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared in this material world, as the son of Mother Sachi, at that time, all the demigods and demigoddesses, they took the form of ordinary villagers so that they could come unknown, unannounced. And they saw that here in this Kali Yuga, here is the form of the Lord coming to benedict the fallen souls. So the Yemi goddess is coming as villagers, as brahmanas, brahmanis. They brought various type of presentations and gave to Jagannath Mishra and Sachi Mata. But otherwise, no one could recognize them, except for very few who had that vision. So in this way, the demigods, they actually are devotees, but they're very concerned for the material happiness of the people and that they are able to progress in God consciousness also. Here you can see that they're very concerned that the living entities don't have any happiness, being overwhelmed by the three kinds of material miseries. You see, in the heavenly planets, by the mercy of Vishnu, they're able to enjoy much less quantity of these material miseries. There's very little disease, problems from the body are to the very minimum, or you can say practically no disease. Old age is just reduced to a very short period before one dies. Death, of course, is there. You cannot escape. Even on these heavenly planets, they're going to suffer death, and again they have to be reborn. And even though the demigods are wanting to be happy, sometimes they're attacked by the demons, and they have to fight and defend themselves. So, even the demigods, they're suffering these three aspects of adi-atmic, adi-bhotic, adi-doivic suffering. We're reminded about a very humble devotee of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu who actually was apparently suffering. His name was Kolavecha Sridhar, the banana salesman Sridhar, devotee of Lord Chaitanya. He was very, very poor. He had his ripped cloth. He had, Prabhupada explained that when you say banana salesman, that in Bengal, where everybody in every house has got plenty of banana trees. So to be a banana salesman there is not very, it's not the most lucrative business to be in. It's like being a coal salesman in Newcastle or something, or selling steel in Pittsburgh. It's everybody has bananas. Only if there's some specific shortage, maybe somebody needs a banana that day. But he was selling bananas, banana leaves, banana flowers, banana center. Actually, the banana tree was a gift to this world by the demigods. It is a flower in Swargaloka. It's one of the Swargaloka plants. And you can see that the banana, every single part of that tree is used. You use the leaves as plates. You use the bark, you can feed to the cows. There's a center part of the banana tree. You chop it up in little pieces, and it's very sweet. It has a little gum in it. You take the gum out, and that's called kolator. And they prepare a very wonderful vegetable from that in Bengal. If you read some of the preparations by Advaita's wife, Sita Thakurani, she prepares this, or in that bhaja bhakata bhatsala sigoraha, you see mocha kandi, like that. So mocha, that means the flower of the banana. The flower of the banana they take and they also make that into a vegetable. And of course the bananas, they're also edible. So everything that the banana is given, it's practically the whole thing is dedicated to the service of the proprietor. So anyway, Kolavecha Sridhar, this was his main business, was selling bananas, and he was very poor. And with 50% of his income, whatever he got, he would worship the Ganges, and the other 50% he would use to maintain himself. So Lord Chaitanya, when he was Nimai Pandit, about 8-9 years old, he'd go shopping for Mother Sachi sometimes, and he'd always go right to Kolavecha Sridhar, his pure devotee, who was worshipping the Ganges every day. So then he would pick up a bunch of bananas and say, "How much is this?" And he'd say, "It's so many little conch shells." "So much! You are simply trying to exploit the poor brahmanas like me, overcharging But Kolavecha Sridhar would always give the exact price. He would never, you know, go more than the market. He said, "You listen, go and ask anybody. Why are you giving me a hard time? This is the price." "No, no, no, I know. You are so rich. What do you mean? I'm very poor." "No, you are very rich. You are just dressing like this to conceal your wealth. Actually, you are very, very rich." Of course, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, everything he says is perfect. And actually, Kolavecha Sridhar was very rich, but his wealth was of the most valuable kind, which is revealed later. Anyway, in this way, Lord Chaitanya and Kolavecha Sridhar, they would sometimes have their arguments over the price. Sometimes Lord Chaitanya would take the bananas and start walking off without paying anything. And Kolavecha said, "What are you doing? How am I going to worship the Ganges if you just take the bananas and don't give anything for them?" And then Lord Chaitanya said, "What do you think? You think I want these bananas for free? Think I don't have any money? You're calling a Brahmana a thief?" And then in this way he would intimidate Srila Kolavecha Sridhar. And then he'd go back and hand them half the price and walk off. "You're simply trying to take too much." Sometimes when he would say, "I'm trying to just worship the Ganges. If you give something, I can do worship to the Ganges." Then Lord Chaitanya would say, "What do you mean? I am the father of the Ganges." Kolavecha, "What do you mean the father of the Ganges is Vishnu himself? Vishnu, Vishnu, Vishnu. How can you say such offensive things?" But then after this was over, he would always think, "Oh wait, what is this? Who is this Nimai Pandit? Whenever I see him, my heart just melts. He wants to take the bananas, but I can't say anything. I don't know what happens when I see him. My hairs stand on end. Just something comes over me. I guess I'm just so fortunate that he comes to me. I just have to accept it as some special mercy. I've never seen anyone like Nimai Pandit. He's so beautiful. His lotus feet, they're perfectly formed right to his lotus eye. I've never seen any Brahmana like this. And so argumentative, This way he would contemplate and be meditating on Lord Chaitanya. But Kolavecha Sridhar's own personal life, many people would criticize him because he was so poor. Because every day after worshipping the Ganges and taking care of his bananas, actually bananas require very little maintenance. So he would have plenty of time and he would spend it reading the Bhagavatam and chanting, especially even late into the night. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So sometimes the local brahmanas, local richer people, they would call him aside. "Listen, Kolavecha, why are you having these ripped cloths? Well, why don't you just stop this Ganges puja? You're giving 50% of your income. Why don't you stop it for a few days, stop it for 1 year, build up your capital, reinvest, you'll have so much money, then you can do a glorious worship for the Mother Ganges. Why this daily 50%? Your clothes are ripped." "No, no. My clothes, my body is covered, there's no problem. And it's very cool in the summer." He would just, "But your house has got holes in it." "No, but that also is like air conditioning." "But the whole night you're just howling." "No, well, it's the holy name." Then they go off on the side and say, "He's just hungry, he can't sleep, so that's why he cries all night." In so many ways they're nasty to him, you know. But he would not, he just ignore it. He just wouldn't be misled. So in this way, maybe by some material valuation, he was very unhappy. But actually, he was the happiest person, being able to see Lord Chaitanya daily worshipping the Ganges, chanting the holy name. So when Lord Chaitanya manifested his Mahaprakash, you see, Lord Chaitanya after the age of 14 when he began his Harinam Sankirtan movement, when he came back from Gaya after the departure of Jagannath Mitra from this world. Then one day Advaita Gosai could sense, he actually had realized who Lord Chaitanya was. That's a whole other long history. And Lord Chaitanya, he came into a specific mood where Lord Chaitanya, one day he just came and sat down on the bed of the deities. And Advaita Gosai, with his transcendental vision, could see that the Lord was in his original mood, that his mood as a devotee, he wasn't in that mood today, that this particular day he was in the mood as the Supreme Personality of God in his original form. And so Advaita Goswami, he started to take tulsi and worship the lotus feet of Lord Chaitanya. Namo Brahmanaya Devaya Go Brahmanya Hitaya Cha Jagad Hitaya Krishnaya Govindaya Namo Namaha. And all of the other devotees, they at first were amazed. That how is this that Advaita Goswami is worshipping Lord Chaitanya as Krishna himself? And then Lord Chaitanya, he revealed his transcendental glory to all of the devotees, where they could actually see that he was none other than the Supreme Personality of Godhead had come in the form of a devotee, but he was actually Krishna himself. And then different demigods, Sukadeva Goswami, the different demigods, they came and they started to worship Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. The Ganges personified, she came on the Ganges River with her carrier. She rides on, I believe it's a dolphin. She came to worship Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And then Lord Chaitanya, he started to reveal the different identity of his different devotees. He revealed to Srivas that he was actually Narada Muni. He revealed to Maradi Gupta that he, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, was Sri Ramachandra, and Maradi Gupta was his eternal devotee, Hanuman. That's why he could only worship Ramachandra, even though he tried to worship Krishna. When Maradi Gupta saw that, he fainted, he was unconscious. In this way, Lord Chaitanya was benedicting different devotees. For 21 hours they had the kirtan, which we meditate upon every night when we sing Kiva Jayo Jayo Gaura Chandra Arotika Sobhe. That 21-hour Mahaprakash Arati, that is especially the subject of our meditation when we do the evening arati. So then suddenly Lord Chaitanya, he called, bring that Kolavecha Sridhar. And so the devotees, they went, Kolavecha Sridhar, the hawker, the peddler on the street, bring him, bring him. So everyone knew he was a devotee, but why Lord Chaitanya was bringing him, they were puzzled. So then they few devotees went to get him. They said, Kolavecha Sridhar, Lord Chaitanya is requesting that you immediately come to see him. Lord Chaitanya, Gauranga Mahaprabhu, see me. He fainted right on the spot. It's too much for him. So they picked him up and carried him all the way to Srivash Angan and to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Placing him before Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, then Kolavecha Sridhar looked, and there he saw Lord Chaitanya was more brilliant than thousands of suns. That on his side was Advaita Goswami. On his side was Nityananda Prabhu holding umbrella. There was the devotees waving chamara, and then all around there are these devotees, all effulgent. The whole material world disappeared in the presence of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. You could only see the form of the Lord and his devotees. The complete transcendental glory was only visible. The material world was no longer visible in the presence of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Just as you cannot see the stars in the presence of the sun, so the material reflections of the spiritual world disappeared in the presence of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then asked Kolavecha Sridhar that you have been worshipping me for so and worshipping the Ganges so faithfully. So now I want to give you a benediction. You tell me, what do you want? I will give you, you may have residence in that, you may have a huge kingdom. You may have a huge kingdom where you can reign and everyone will follow you. Kolarcha Sridhar said, Prabhu, Master, I do not want a kingdom. I'm giving you a kingdom. I don't want a kingdom. All right, you can take residence in the heavenly planets as one of the demigods. I don't want to go to the heavenly planets. I will give you mukti, liberation. You may have liberation. Kolavecha Sridhar, he said, my Lord, I don't want liberation. Liberation from the three modes of material nature, from the three miseries. Complete liberation. My Lord, sorry, but I do not want liberation. Then what do you want? Tell me, I can have whatever you want. Just see, these demigods are praying for the Lord. But in the end, they're going to ask so they can do the creation, so they can do their material duties properly. Of course, they're all devotees, and we respect them. But here, Kolavecha Sridhar has shown a quality which is beyond even the greatest sages who desire liberation, or those demigods who desire to have material benediction. Kolavecha Sridhar wasn't desiring any of this. What was he desiring? When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, so what do you want? Kolavecha Sridhar said, kindly give me that benediction, that whenever you appear, I can supply the vegetables, bananas, banana leaf plates, all your vegetable needs. I simply want to see that smiling, mischievous face of that young brahmana, Nimai, Pandit, who is coming. I simply want, and if I'm not able to, if I'm unworthy to serve you, when you, wherever you are, then at least allow me to serve your pure devotees. Allow me to render service to the devotees of the Lord. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in front of all of the devotees who are performing kirtan, and the arati is going on, then he said, Kolavecha Sridhar, I'm benedicting you. You may have pure Krishna prema, that thing which even the demigods, even Shiva, even Brahma, they find it difficult to have. You, they're hankering for it eagerly. You may have pure love for Krishna. Then the devotees, they went wild. They're jumping up and chanting, Harivo, Harivo. This is the nature of a liberation offered by me, Krishna said, to my devotee. Dinanti na grinanti. Even you offer them, they will not accept. Matsheva vina. Without my devotional service. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he offered his devotees all facility. But they didn't want it. They only wanted his pure, eternal devotional service, or to serve his devotee. This is the special glory of those pure devotees of Krishna, the pure devotees of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that they're not even concerned with ending the three miseries of material life. Because if they have pure love for Krishna, if they have the eternal devotional service of Krishna, where is the question of material misery? They're already on the transcendental liberated platform. Even in this world, if we're fully absorbed in hearing, and rather in serving with our mind, with our words, and with our bodies, with our activities, the lotus feet of the Lord and His devotees, we're already considered liberated. Where is the misery for such devotees? Such devotees are always experiencing transcendental bliss. Even if externally it appears that they're physically suffering, or they may be impoverished, or they may be sick, or whatever, they're never not experiencing the spiritual bliss in union or in separation of the service of the Lord. This is the wonderful quality of devotional service. Iha yasya hrir dasye karmana manasagira nikalasvatyavastasu jivan mukta sa uchate. So in the holy dham, where the Lord's pastimes are there, that is also above the three modes of material nature. The dham is simply meant for engaging in hearing, chanting, remembering, engaging in the nine folds of devotional practices of devotional service. It's simply meant for engaging thoughts, words, and activities in the devotional service. If one is in the dham and recognizes one's relationship as the eternal servant of the Lord, then that person is already considered to be above the material influence. So we have to cultivate this relationship with Krishna, this understanding that I am the servant of the servant in the dham, and then it's very easy to be above this influence of the three modes of material nature. So, without any offense meant to the demigods, but we take this opportunity to glorify especially those pure devotees who are visible in different bodies, either demigod or human or animal, who have completely given their thoughts, words, and deeds to the lotus feet of the Lord. They are transcendental to all the miseries of life, and they have achieved the highest perfection of life. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Ramo, 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 Hare Hare. I think there might be time for one question or so. Any question? Yes? Yes, Krishna, he only stole butter. You see, Krishna came and he went, and he's sometimes known as having the pastimes of a Vaishya. He came, and in his childhood, he used to steal butter and give it to the monkeys. He used to play with the cowherd boys in the field with Lord Chaitanya. He came down as a brahmana, as a devotee. So, brahmanas, their play is more mental, very mischievous mentally. So Lord Chaitanya, he would go sometimes to the Ganges, and he'd splash water on the brahmanas, saying their Gayatri, pull their feet out from under them. He would, sometimes someone would come and he'd take the men's clothes and put them with the women's clothes, take the women's clothes, put them with the men, and they come out, it'd be very embarrassing. But he was only 4, 5, 6 years old, 7, playing so many little. So this is actually preparing a certain setting so that the devotees, actually all these residents of Navadvip, they were devotees of Krishna. And this was a special benediction. So then the man would go and they'd approach to Jagannath Misra's house, and they would complain that that your son is doing so much mischief, we can't do our puja, he's going there and he's taking the clothes, and sometimes he's splashing, and we're trying to do our puja, and we're trying to do Ganges puja, and he comes and takes the articles, says, I'm the father of the Ganges. What kind of a son do you have? What? You have to do something. He's going to go bad if you don't discipline him. He's down there right now in the Ganges. You should see, he's a terror down there. And so then, Jagannath says, all right, I'm going just now. Meanwhile, the daughters of the brahmanas, they came and they said, this Nimai Pandit, he comes to us and we're trying to worship the Ganges. Oh, he takes the worship. Why don't you worship me? That was actually what happened. And then sometimes he runs, he says, listen, I'll benedict you that you can have many children. You can have a good husband. You just have to offer the worship. How can he do all these things? And then sometimes he jumps out from nowhere and he scares us. And he's just, you must do. But then they saw that Jagannath Mahaprabhu said, all right, I'm going now. Then they became very frightened. Oh, maybe he's going to punish Nimai Pandit. So they ran down to the river and said, Nimai Pandit, watch out, your father's coming. Then, you know, there he was playing with all the cowherd boy, you know, the other brahmanas. They're all, you know, from liberated souls who get to play with the Lord like this. So immediately he has a little huddle with them. Quarterback, you know, he has a little huddle with them. They have their strategy. He's out of the water. So then coming with a stick, here comes Jagannath Mr. All right, where's Nimai? Nimai, have you seen Nimai? We're waiting here. We're waiting for him to come here to the river. Can you send him from his house? We've all been waiting here for so long, he hasn't come. This is something, he said, all those brahmanas, how the senior citizens, you know, how would they? They'd all come and they'd say something. No, no, we haven't seen Nimai the whole day. So then he went back to, meanwhile, Nimai Pandit, he appeared at his house somehow. His body was all filled with dust. He had ink spots on his hand. His hair was completely dry. He says, Mother Sachi, just come home from school. I'm real hungry. I want to go and take my bath in the Ganges now. She looked. No sign of taking any bath, no wrinkled fingers, no wet hair, dusty ink spots from this cloth. Jagannath Mistra came back. He looked. All right. Couldn't figure it out. Go take your bath. Then he went back. Again began his. So this was, you know, Lord Chaitanya is actually, even when they saw Jagannath Mistra, the brahmanas became afraid. No, no. We just were saying, but don't beat Nimai. He's a very nice boy, actually. Actually, it was just they were so eager to talk about Lord Chaitanya, they took any opportunity. This was just a way that all the devotees could engage in different kind of glorification of the Lord in his childhood pastimes. Just like the cowherd boys in Vrindavan. I mean, the cowherd, you know, men, they would complain that Krishna is coming and stealing our butter and he's feeding it to the monkeys. You have to do something. This is a pastime of Krishna because it's not a worship with awe and reverence. It's intimate. It's parental, friendship, and conjugal. It's a different mood of a very familiar service. So for that reason, they have these mischievous pastimes in his childhood. But of course, then later he gets on to his serious business, whatever that may be. He gets on to his other pastimes. But his that mischievousness, that quality is there in the personality of Godhead. But in him it's perfect. It actually inspires the love of his devotees. Hare Krishna.